In the name of God, my name is Mehdi Kurtnavasi. This is the 8th movie about the software architecture design. And in this movie, we will talk about the object-oriented architectural style. Object-oriented architecture is a design paradigm based on the division of responsibilities for an application or system into individual reusable and self-sufficient objects, each containing the data and the behavior relevant to the object. An object-oriented design views a system as a series of cooperating objects, instead of a set of routines or procedural instructions. Objects are discrete, independent, and loosely coupled. They communicate through interfaces by calling methods or accessing properties in other objects, and by sending and receiving messages. The main benefits are understandable. It maps the application more closely to the real-world objects, making it more understandable. The second is reusable. It provides for reusability through polymorphism and abstraction. The next is testable. It provides for improved testability through encapsulation. Extensible, encapsulation, polymorphism, and abstractions ensure that the object exposes, which would limit the capability to communicate and interact with other objects. The next benefit is highly cohesive. By locating only related methods and features in an object and using different objects for different sets of features, you can achieve a high level of cohesion. Okay, let's see a short movie, 5 minutes, very useful movie about the object-oriented design.
It's a common question from people new to programming. Is there one process, one roadmap, one predefined template that will take me through all the necessary steps from start to finish to make a piece of software? And no, there isn't one process. There are many that promise to help you do just that. These are just a few of the formal software development methodologies. Now, why so many? Well, first and most simply, because software development isn't one thing. If I want to build a quiz application for my iPhone, that requires one level of thought, one style of planning. But if I want to build an international banking system or a safety monitoring system for a nuclear reactor, that's something quite different. So some of these are quite loose and informal, and some are very formal, detailing every aspect of what's called the software development lifecycle, including project management and people management, budgeting, documentation requirements, down to how many meetings you should have and how often those meetings should occur. But this is not what we're doing in this course. What we're doing here is part of these. It would work with any software development process, formal or informal. We're working on the part where we understand our problem and design a solution, not on budgeting, not on personnel. An object-oriented design will tell you what classes to write. It won't tell you how many people your team should have, It won't tell you what platform to build this on. It won't estimate how long this project should take, but it can help you figure these things out if you need to. Now, if you work in an organization, you may have one of these formal methodologies already in place, or something that's been developed in-house and unique to your company, or something loose and informal, or no process at all. I'm not expecting any particular methodology. The one assumption I am going to make is that we're using an agile, iterative approach to developing software as opposed to a waterfall approach. Now, if those terms are new to you, let me briefly explain. In the first decades of software development, and even when I started programming, it was usual to have what was referred to as a waterfall approach, a strict linear plan with several distinct steps. You'd go through this methodology step by step, completely finishing each step, getting signed off, and moving on to the next one. Sounds like a good approach, just one problem. It doesn't work. The moment you get to implementation, to writing code, you're going to hit problems you didn't think of. You're going to get new requirements that will make whatever you wrote in the first phase seem like a joke. Your customer is going to change their mind. You're going to change your mind. So this kind of approach might work for building a suspension bridge. It doesn't work very well for software. Software development needs to be responsive. We need to add new features. We need to fix bugs. We need to support continual development. That's continual programming supported by continual analysis and design. So instead, we use an iterative or agile approach. We imagine that any development will involve several incremental cycles, iterations, each including analysis, design, and programming. These are measured in weeks, not months, and that we'll move through these multiple times. Now, this is a much more effective approach for most projects, and it's a great one for us, and that we don't have to know everything up front. We don't need to create a perfect analysis and design. In fact, we expect our initial iterations to be inaccurate and incomplete, and we'll improve them as we go. Now, if you think your first object-oriented design is perfect, it's either very small or you probably spent too long on it. It's not meant to be perfect. It's meant to be good enough. And that's our focus in this course. Just enough design to let us move forward successfully. So there are four fundamental ideas in object-oriented programming. Four things to keep in mind when creating classes. They have the wonderful terms abstraction, polymorphism, inheritance, and encapsulation. And one way to remember these is with the acronym API. Now, these terms can sound intimidating, but you do most of them already in daily thought and conversation, even if you don't use these actual words. Let me prove that with the first one, abstraction. If I say table, you know what I mean. I didn't say if I was thinking of a wooden table or glass top table, if it had four legs or one central pillar, if it was large or if it was small. You might have an image in mind, that's okay, but I don't have to get that specific because you understand the idea of a table, the abstraction of a table. You have seen and experienced enough real tables to abstract the idea of what a table means. Abstraction means we focus on the essential qualities of something rather than one specific example. And abstraction means that we automatically will discard what's unimportant or irrelevant. So your mental model of a table might have a potential height and width, but it's unlikely to have an engine size or flavor because those things are irrelevant to the idea of a table. So abstraction means that we can have an idea or a concept that is completely separate from any specific instance. It's what we do all the time in conversation, and it's at the heart of object-oriented programming because it's what we're doing when we make a class. Abstraction means that we don't create one class for Joe's bank account and a separate class for Alice's bank account. We will focus on the essential qualities of the idea, and we will write one bank account class. We'll focus on things like each of these will have an account number. Each of these will have a balance. And because we always want to discard what's unimportant, it's never just, what does a bank account class look like? It's, what should a bank account class look like for this application, under these circumstances, at this time, focusing always just on the essentials. So it might be true that every bank account was opened on a specific date. But if our application doesn't care about that piece of information, we don't need that attribute defined in our class. But as we'll see, it's abstraction that is the foundation that supports other fundamentals of object orientation, such as inheritance and polymorphism.
Abstraction. This allows you to reduce a complex operation into a generalization that retains the base characteristics of the operation. For example, an abstract interface can be a well-known definition that supports data access operating using simple methods such as get and update. Another form of abstraction could be metadata, used to provide a mapping between two formats that hold structured data. Composition. Objects can be assembled from other objects and can choose to hide these internal objects from other classes or expose them as simple interfaces. Inheritance. Objects can inherit from other objects and use functionality in the base object or override it to implement new behavior. Moreover, inheritance makes maintenance and update easier and changes to the base objects are propagate automatically to the inheriting objects. Encapsulation. Objects expose functionality only through methods, properties, and events, and hide the internal details such as state and variables from other objects. This makes it easier to update or replace objects as long as their interfaces are compatible without affecting other objects and code. Polymorphism. This allows you to override the behavior of a base type that supports operations in your application by implementing new types that are interchangeable with the existing object. The next is decoupling. Objects can be decoupled from the consumer by defining an abstract interface that objects implement and the consumer can understand. This allows you to provide alternative implementations without affecting consumers of the interface. Okay, let's see the next movie. A good explanation about the object-oriented programming.
Gareth Schulte here. In this micro nugget, we're going to talk about something called object-oriented programming, which is really just a design philosophy, a technique that we can use to build our applications that will bring a lot of benefits to our application. The big one being code separation. So rather than like the old days where we just built applications by writing lines and lines of code that were really just small tasks that did stuff and they were all interrelated and they would call each other, what we like to call these days spaghetti code, we bring that clear separation to our code by creating these modular components, which also promotes code reuse. So now we can build it once, and then anybody that needed to use that kind of functionality could tap into our component rather than reinvent the wheel. And that's really just scratching the surface of object-oriented programming. So let's take a look at and get some examples going here of how it can help us, and I'll give you a little bit of the advanced side of object-oriented programming to talk about how it works and how to design your class hierarchies, which are really your data models. All right, so square one here. Let's say that we are that spaghetti programmer. We were tasked with the project of building an employee application within our company. All right, so we have an employee application. We threw it together. We got this beautiful front end, and underneath, it's just one big spaghetti-coated mess. It's a big bowl of SpaghettiOs. And let's say a couple months down the road, this application works great, works fine. A couple months down the road, the boss says, hey, I need another employee application, but I need it a little bit different. And we're like, all right, okay, well, so we're going to build another nice front end here, an employee application, and half the code we need is in here. So what do? We open this project, we copy all that code out of here, and we paste it into this application. Now, we've got the same code in multiple places. What happens when a couple months down the road, we find a bug and we need to fix it? That's right, now we need to go and fix it here, we need to go and fix it here, and you can see where this is going. Now, let's see how object-oriented programming can help alleviate some of the coding issues, the big one being code reuse or the lack thereof in our first example. So what we do with object-oriented programming is we would create something called a class. And think of a class as really just a data model. It's a structure that stores data about whatever you're trying to model. So in our case, let's say that we wanted to create an employee class. Classes contain the three big things here: properties, methods, and events. These three things pretty much encapsulate everything that an object can do. Properties are the data points, you know, first name, last name, department, salary, hire date, terminate date, is active. I mean, all the data points that you could think about for an employee could be a property. Methods are actions that the employee can perform or things that could be performed on the employee. So really think of them as tasks. And if we were to create an employee class, we could create methods such as promote or pay or terminate or do work or, my favorite, call in sick. Just kidding. Hopefully the boss isn't watching this micro nugget. All right, the last one we have then is events. And an event is something that could occur, something that happens that we may want to allow anybody that's using our employee class to handle. For instance, we could create an on-called-in-sick event, which would allow anybody using this class to define and handle that event. They could write code that said, hey, whenever somebody calls in sick, send a notification out to everybody in the company that they won't be in today. So that's really all a class is. It's just a data structure that contains everything that we would want to track for an employee, that employee could do, and that could happen to an employee. So once we define this class, we could allow ourselves to use it in our applications, we could allow other developers to use it, and what they would do then is they would create what's called instances of this class, which would turn them into live objects stored in memory that they could work with, and every object that we create from this class could represent a different employee. So think of our classes as blueprints. And this is just like in the real world when architects and carpenters get together to construct, say, a house. The architects are going to design a blueprint. The carpenters are going to build that physical house based on the blueprint. Same exact concept here. Classes are blueprint. Our objects are the real live versions of that blueprint that we then use within our applications. Now, once again, let's take this to the next level. Now, the real beauty of object-oriented programming comes into play when you create multiple classes that all work together, an interrelated class hierarchy, because take our employee class, for instance. We're not just going to create an employee class. We're going to have employee classes that represent specific employees, because that do work function that we talked about, well, do work's going to mean something different if you're a factory worker than if you're an HR worker, right? But at the same time, they are still both employees. So what we can do is at the very top of our hierarchy, we can create something called a base class, a base employee class. An employee class that we could use to define all the common things, no matter what kind of an employee they are. So here's where we can put all of our properties, first name, last name, title, you know, all the things that every single employee would have. And we could still even define that do work method, even though it's going to be implemented differently down in the chain, depending on the kind of worker, but we could still define that it exists. Now, this would be considered an abstract class, because see how it's dimmed out? That means that nobody could create a live object of this class, because it wouldn't make any sense. So that's why we used it as kind of a placeholder. It's a blueprint for our blueprints. Think of it like that. Now let's head down the chain a little bit here, and let's say that we wanted to create a class called CFO. And this will be a concrete class, meaning we would allow our application developers to create live objects based on this class because they would want to create a CFO class to work with. So that would be something that would be a concrete class. And we could put stuff inside of this class that's CFO specific. You know, things like pay employee, view salaries, all that CFO related stuff. We could also then create a CEO class that derived from our CFO class because the CEO should be able to get everything or see everything or do everything that a CFO can do. So you can kind of start to see how this hierarchy works. Now on this side, let's say that we wanted to create a worker class. Still pretty generic, still abstract, because we could have some things in here that relate to all workers. Not all employees are workers, however, that do worker stuff, but all workers are employees. So now we could start creating worker-specific concrete classes. We could create things like, you know, an HR worker. We could create a factory worker or a warehouse worker, and the list goes on and on. And when we're done constructing our class hierarchy, we can compile this into a code module, something called a .dll. And now we can redistribute that .dll to anybody who wanted to build an application that needed to work with employees within our company. And this would solve our first issue that we talked about here with code reuse, because now we can build multiple applications that all target that .dll and create employee objects all day long, and we have one centralized location where all that code lives. So if we ever need to add more types of employees, not a big deal. We can add them in, redistribute our .dll to anybody that's using our application, and they can tap in and program against that new functionality. So now what we've done is we've introduced meatballs into our spaghetti, what's known as spaghetti and meatball coding, because people can now write spaghetti code against our objects. Our objects are the meatballs. But that's a whole other design philosophy for another day. In this micro-nugget, we saw what object-oriented programming is all about. We saw that it's really just a way that we can model real-world objects and turn them into their digital counterparts. And by doing so, we bring code separation and code modularity into our application, which also allows us to promote code reuse across applications. I hope this has been informative for you, and I thank you for viewing.
Okay, thank you for watching this movie. And for the next movie, we will talk about the service-oriented architectural style, or SOA. Thank you.